from a dark, damp, stinky, moldy basement in a haunted dwelling somewhere in the black swamp of Northwest Ohio. This is Swamp Gas, and I am your host, Arizona Tramp. Now, guys, yeah, like I was telling you about a second ago, but I couldn't because I didn't have the mic set properly. In the next week there, I plan on having an email list for you so that you can get updates in the email as to who is on the show, what the topics will be on the show, what's going on with the website, all that good, cool stuff that you just want to know so much about. Anyhow, I want to talk a minute about this new Michigan bill. Have you heard about the new bill going out in Michigan? Well, back when they were making all the hoopla about gay marriage, Michigan became one of those states that finally allowed gay marriage. And now they have a bill that says that oral sex and sodomy are illegal. So you can be married to your partner if you're gay or if you're lesbian. I don't know what the difference is. Gay is gay. I never did quite understand that. But you can't have sex with your partner because it's illegal. What the hell? Is this their way of fighting back against gay marriage so they make it illegal to have sex with each other? What is going on with these people, man? It is not making any frickin' sense to me whatsoever. It's just okay that in Flint, Michigan, they can poison the water supply with lead. And that issue's all right because, oh, well, it went through the proper channels before we poisoned the water, so it's not terrorism, but we're going to make up this law that says it's illegal for you guys to have sex because we want to be jerk-offs. What the hell, man? Dude, that's all I got to say is, dude. Dude. And then, I don't know if you guys watched the Super Bowl or not. I don't know if you guys saw the commercial for PayPal or if you saw Lady Gaga's BS. But very fast now, within the next, I would say within the next 12 to 16 months, they're going to turn around and crash the economy so that they can start up the Bitcoin. So they can crash the economy, make people beg for change, and then they come out with the Bitcoin. What does this mean? Well, this means I can no longer have a yard sale to get rid of my crap without registering. This means if I get busted at the side of the road and I need to flag somebody down and get $5 for gas, I can't get a transaction like that unless the government's involved. This, you know, somebody can't just, you know, hand me $5 so I can get me a tank, a couple gallons of gas. If you want to give the homeless guy standing on the corner $5, well, this guy's not going to have a bank account. He's not going to be able to accept the Bitcoin. So how do you help this guy out? You have to, maybe you're a woman. You don't want this guy in your car to take him to get something to eat. So, you know, you want to help him, but the government won't allow you to help him. This is complete and total BS. It's the type of crap that I'm always ranting about, and I don't want to turn this into a political show, and I'm not going to. But anyhow, we've got a good show for you tonight. We have Sonia Thompson. Sonia Thompson, she's a real sweetheart, but I had to do a pre-record, and I'll explain to you why. She works her butt off all day long, and by the time this show's on at night, she's in bed. She's snoring logs because she's got to get up at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning for her job. And so here's the pre-record, and it'll tell you all about what's going on with her. And she's a pretty, I like this lady. She's a sweetheart, let me tell you. guess what I've got? Have you ever talked to a real-life zombie before in your life? I got one. Her name is Sonya Thompson, and she plays a walker on The Walking Dead. She's been in quite a few episodes. She's also doing her own producing, correct?
Yes.
And she's been in several other movies. We will get to those here shortly. Sonya Thompson has played roles from detective to zombie, not only in film, but also on primetime TV. Although she has done many roles, what she is known best for is her main zombie roles in the film Zombieland and the hit TV show The Walking Dead, seasons 1 and 2. Her modeling experience came in handy as a promo zombie for the TV show The Walking Dead, and those photos are some of the most seen photos in the world of advertisement. She has been featured on the magazine covers of Entertainment Weekly, SFX Magazine, SFX's Ultimate Zombie Guide, SFX's A to Z of Zombies, SFX's A to Z of Horror, Film Inc. and DVD Review. Her image has also been utilized on posters, t-shirts, billboards, DVD and Blu-ray covers. Was also featured in The Walking Dead comic book issue 75 alongside the main cast. One of her most loved roles was on the web series Lumbar Baron of Jasper County, in which she played the role of a tomboy named Sam. Other roles include Catherine in the movie LWA All Saints Eve, Alice in the movie Chronologically, starring Billy Baldwin and Danny Trejo, Victoria Studebaker in the film Prosper, Flo in the film This Old Machine, and I can go on and on and on. She has appeared in H2 as a dead nurse, Van Wilder freshman year as a professor, and many more. Writing, singing, and drawing are other important talents of Sonya's. She has written in Zombie Guide called I Am Zombie, Hear Me Roar. She has also written a script. She appeared on Good Day Live in Louisville, Kentucky, Good Morning Carolinas, and Channel 4 News in South Carolina, and several podcasts on the web. Segment direction in the movie Cry for Revenge that has Christina Lindbergh starring in it, and producer and co-director on the web series Akita. Welcome, Sonya.
I'm going to ask the question that I know everybody wants to know about. What's it like to dress up in makeup, get paid to be a zombie?
It's work. It's a lot of hard work, and a lot of people don't understand that. I've always been one of those type of people that loved Halloween, loved to dress up. Every chance I got, I dressed up, even if it wasn't Halloween. And after you've pulled 16-hour days on The Walking Dead, and I did that on Halloween, too, as a dead nurse as well, and also on Zombieland, wasn't an extremely long day, but still, you know, when you're wearing that makeup, it's not like you can just go home when you're ready to take it off.
Why?
You know? You have to keep it on until the filming's done, so, you know, the contacts and everything can be kind of crazy at times, but...
Well, what I was meaning there, Sonya, I was meaning, like, after you're done working, why not go home and look like a zombie and freak your neighbors?
Well, you know, if they would have liked for me to have wore it home, I probably would have.
Well,
they wouldn't allow us to leave the set with it on.
I can understand, but I don't see how you going home as a zombie is a TV spoiler. But yeah, their rules are their rules.
Yeah, but I will tell you a scenario that happened one time. I was driving home for Halloween 2, Rob Zombie's version. I was a dead nurse that night, and I had been there 16-hour day, and I was extremely tired. And I tried to get as much blood off of me as I could before I drove the hour home. And I still had like a cut across my face. And I decided to stop off at the area McDonald's drive-thru on the way home, and had completely forgot about having that cut across my face. And so I ordered my food, I went to the next window to pay, and the young man turned white as a ghost. And I said, "Sir, what is wrong with you? are you okay? And he said, I'm trying to make sure you're okay. I started laughing. I was like, oh, honey, I'm fine. This is just makeup. I said, I just got through filming on a movie. And of course, you know, I couldn't tell him what I had been working on, but it was so funny. The look on his face was priceless.
Wow. So what's it like having to sit there and have people playing with you for hours till your makeup's done?
Oh, that's my favorite part. I feel like I'm the canvas, and they're putting their art on me. And as I sit there, I'm watching in the mirror, and I'm trying to figure out, how am I going to play this zombie today? You know, I'm watching where they put the prosthetics on my face, where they put the bite marks on my neck, or whatever they were doing to me that day. I'm trying to figure out how to pull that inner zombie out to make it scary, to make it come to life, so to speak. So that is always my favorite part to do, is watching the makeup process. And I have had makeup put on me where I did not have a mirror in front of me, and I couldn't wait to get up. I couldn't see anything. I wanted to be able to watch the process.
Oh, yeah, that would be fun. Now, when you're, does the director just give you a general idea of what he wants out of you, or is he specific?
Most of the time, they're very specific as to what they want. They'll go over the scene with us. Sometimes the production assistants will read the script to us for that day's scene, so we can get a better idea of what we're going to be doing and what to be expecting, especially if there's blank guns on the set, or, you know, there's going to be stunts or whatever. You know, you just got to be prepared. And Frank Darabont was very hands-on when I worked with him. He's one of the best directors I've ever worked with. And he would actually get out there and show you, hey, I want you to be in their face, or I want you to do this. So it was really incredible working with an award-winning director.
That's awesome. So I take it you know the entire cast?
Not the entire cast, but a good bit of them. With me being one of the main walkers on the show, I got the opportunity to work very closely with several of them, like Stephen Yeun and Irony Singleton and Andrew Lincoln and Chandler Riggs and, you know, just even Norman Reedus, you know, so...
There you go.
There's it was, a yeah, you can't forget him, right? Yeah, I mean, he's important.
There's a question for you, all right? Just for all you ladies out there, is Norman as sexy in real life as he is, or your fantasies, on TV?
Well, you know, I've always been a Andrew Lincoln type of gal, so it's hard for me to you know, say that he's sexy, because I don't know, he doesn't have that British accent like Andrew does. But I guess from a redneck point of view, I guess he would be very sexy and handsome.
Okay. I like Carol. Carol seems to be, I like what she grew into. I like the character that she grew into, from being a woman who was a victim, mm-hmm. to being a woman that will take your life in a blink of an eye.
I know. I've really loved the way her character has grown myself, and it's amazing how strong she is now. And you have to wonder if some of the abuse that she had to deal with when she was married, if maybe that's what's coming out right now. Maybe that's what she's fighting. She's still dealing with those inner demons. And when she kills somebody and you know, does what she does, it's making her a stronger woman, you know, because she feels like, okay, I'm overcoming this. I'm the badass now. You know?
Oh, yeah. She doesn't want to do it, but she does it, and she doesn't have an issue with doing it. So, enough about The Walking Dead. Why don't we go on to your other accomplishments there? I understand that you are a director, and what have you directed?
Well, I did segment directing on a grindhouse film called Cry for Revenge with Christina Lindbergh. She is a wonderful person from what I understand, because the segments that I directed did not have her in it. which would have been really great, because it would have been a great honor to have met such an iconic figure, you know, because all the Kill Bill movies were based on her movies and her characters.
Right.
But that was a really neat thing. And then, you know, I've also co-directed on a few web series and done some things like that and produced. I'm wanting to get more involved with that because I really like being behind the camera and directing people, and you know, it's good to have a vision and then have other people bring it to life.
Yeah, I think, I don't know if I would have the ability to direct people and tell them exactly what they wanted to do without me getting pissed off real easy. So that's probably why I don't do it. So what movies have you been in? What's your latest stuff?
I have been in a ton of movies. Actually, even before The Walking Dead, I had, I was in Zombieland. I was a featured zombie in that.
Oh, you were?
Yes.
Is Woody a good actor? Do you think?
Well, you know, I think he's an excellent actor. But he was there that day, but he was in the trailer behind me when I was getting my makeup done. And so I didn't have the chance to meet him, but I did meet Abigail. She's a very nice young lady and very friendly, and so that was my favorite zombie role that I've ever portrayed. I had my own trailer with a star on it, and the eye contacts were smaller than the ones that I wore on The Walking Dead, and it was an amazing movie to be a part of. I really enjoyed the director, Ruben Fisher, on that. He's a great guy, very laid back.
Was there an extreme difference? Because Zombieland, the zombies would walk and run real fast and climb, where in The Walking Dead, they don't do that so much.
Yeah, there was a difference. I was also in the Zombieland training video, and part of that made it to the DVD. And we discussed a lot of that, you know, and every zombie actor had to watch that training video to become a zombie actor on the film. And so, you know, we discussed a lot of the quicker motions and how viruses would affect, you know, the body, and how, you know, you would be quicker when there was food. And, you know, I mean, it was very extreme, but it was, to me, a lot easier than The Walking Dead. But the day was much shorter. It was only like a 6-hour day compared to a 16-hour day. So I guess that's where maybe the difference was. But I do like the slower-moving zombies better.
Slower-moving to me would make more sense, even though I don't even buy the zombie thing at all. But I love The Walking Dead, don't get me wrong. And Zombieland was awesome.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite zombie movies. And I like 28 Days Later or whatever that one is, too. That was a pretty good one, but... I don't know. I mean, Zombieland still, I mean, it's just funny as all get out. You know, I mean, love watching it in the Twinkies. And
I've only seen the first one.
Yeah, you know, the banjo zombie scene in the store. If you look on the shelf to the right, there's Twinkies sitting on the shelf. Yeah, so you have to wonder if they were placed there on purpose to see how many people would notice, or if they just didn't notice they were there when they filmed the scene.
So what else have you done?
Well, I've most recently worked with Billy Baldwin, Danny Trejo, and John James on a movie in Greenville, South Carolina called Chronology. And basically, it's two different movies based on these two different guys' lives. But there's some time travel involved, and it's kind of like a Freaky Friday type thing where they change bodies and get to see the point of view of each other. And It's a karmatic type thing, but it's a gothic thriller, and hopefully it'll be out at the end of this year. I'm pretty excited about it. I play the role of Alice, and I'm the mother of one of the main characters, which is really nice. So I'm looking forward to that one coming out. I'm pretty excited and stoked about it. And also last year I was in a movie called LWA, All Saints Eve. And the writer-director was on season 5 of Face Off on the Science Fiction Channel. And there were 3 or 4 others involved with the movie from Face Off. And it was just a great honor to get to work with all of them. And I had a starring role, and I play the role of Catherine, and she's an ex-military person, and it's a voodoo swamp tour. And
cool.
Anyway, there's a whole bunch of creatures and monsters and everything in it, and that's pretty cool.
It sounds like something I want to see.
Yeah, you will. They be sure to check it out on Facebook, because the creatures are just, I mean, they're just awesome. It's really great. I worked 3 months on it up in Nashville, Tennessee, and Louise Mandrell, she's not in it, but we filmed on the property next door to her, and she is just a wonderful woman. She let us in her home and let us do hair and makeup there, and that was just, she's just such a phenomenal person. Plus she's a legend, you know, not as big a legend as her sister Barbara Mandrell, but still it was just a great honor to be in her presence and everything. Also there's a movie called Sick People I think you'll like. It's going to be out soon. It's got C. Thomas Howell in it, Jasmine Guy, Kristen Dalton from Dead Zone, and Lynn Shay. So it's about a nurse that mistreated some of her patients, and I'm one of the patients that comes back to haunt her. So once again, it's a really cool movie too to check out. And I've done plenty of other movies, but those are some of my most recent that I want to get out there and let you guys know about. The little web series that I produced and co-directed on and called Acadia, that's a really good one. Check that one out on Facebook. And did a movie with Kevin Sorbo a few years back called This Old Machine. I play the role of Flo. Anyway, there's a whole bunch of stuff. Just if you go on my fan page, I post about some of these things, and you can keep up with things that way. But I'm trying to, you know, grow and continue to do bigger and better things.
That sounds awesome. Now, I'm not going to keep you forever today. But, as you know, Black Swamp Radio is all about scary, paranormal, UFO-type deals. And so, since we talked last time, has anything strange happened to you?
Oh, well, let's see. I can't think of anything majorly strange. But, you know, I mean, when I was younger, I saw, you know, a whole bunch of lights going down on the other side of the road, and there's a lake over there. It got really bright over there, and as quickly as it got bright over there, it just kind of like disappeared. So ever since then, I've just decided that there has to be something out there. And maybe I should be on the X-Files.
Hey, maybe you'll get lucky and get a job there sometime.
You never know. My agent is constantly putting me out there and getting me auditions on things. So you just don't ever know.
Well, since we talked last, I have moved a couple of times because we lost a house that we had before, and then we moved into a townhouse. Then we moved into another house, and now we're here. We own this property.
Awesome.
The previous owner's she was married twice. Both husbands died here.
Oh, wow.
And this house, there's a reason from a dark basement in a haunted dwelling.
Because, oh, wow.
You know, and then I'm living in the swamp part of the area. I've got swamp 400 yards behind me.
Oh, man.
So it can get really spooky, and when it's dark here, it's dark. So
just don't accidentally sleepwalk and walk into the swamp, and you'll be okay.
No, I don't do that. I'm not worried about that.
Well, you know, we could have filmed there for the movie in Nashville. That would have been the perfect location.
Well, yeah, it would, except, I don't know.
Well, if we do a number two movie of it, I'll be sure to keep you in mind.
We've got over an acre of land here that y'all could use, and I know my neighbors, they would have no problem. no problem at all letting you use it, you know, so.
That'd be incredible. We filmed a good bit of the swamp scenes up in Realfoot Lake in northwestern Tennessee, right there at the Kentucky border. And that place, I tell you what, it's just incredible. It was all—it was created by an earthquake, one of the largest earthquakes recorded in North American history. And you wouldn't think of that being in Tennessee, but it was. You should look it up, Realfoot Lake. I mean, that place is really cool. Neat place.
I will look that up. I will definitely look that up. Next time. We can't wait so long next time. We're going to have
you got to get me on again soon.
Yeah, we're going to have to get you on real soon again. I'm getting better people on the show now. So, but as it stands right now, and I'm supposed to have Amy Ankin. Do you know who she is? She's the one that runs the Walking Dead Facebook page, fan page.
Oh, okay. I'm not sure if I know her.
Well, she took over for Libby.
Oh, okay.
Okay. And, she's going to be on the show. I'm going to try to make sure that she's on the show coming up right after you.
Okay.
And, I'm sorry, people, that it was pre-recorded and that you can't call in and ask Sonia some questions, but you know, things happen and we can only do things when we can do them, because people's schedules sometimes just make it be that way. And Sonia, thank you so much for coming back on the show. I really appreciate this.
And thank you for having me back.
You are welcome back anytime. We are on TuneIn now. The podcast is on TuneIn, and you know, it's called Swamp Gas. So you can go just do a search and tune in for Swamp Gas, and I'm the only one thing that comes up.
Okay.
So it'd be real easy for you to find. I know how some people are kind of like weird about wanting to download things. But if you go to TuneIn, then you don't have to go to my site directly. You know.
Anyhow. That's as far as that interview got. I hope you enjoyed it. Sonia will be on sometime here in the next few months to do an entire show. But it was kind of short notice for this one. I got a hold of her, and a week later she was on the show. Or no, 2 weeks later, excuse me. She's got a very hectic and busy schedule, as you might think she does. But she's a sweetheart, and she'll make time to come back and talk to you guys again. Take your questions this time. She so wanted to be able to do that, and she just can't stay awake that long. All right, and the next guest that I have on here for the next 5 minutes or so, this is Eli from Switzerland. A couple of people had sent Eli my way, and I went ahead and we talked this morning. And I did a short little thing while he was sitting in the parking lot waiting for his wife to get out of the... they took their kid to the hospital, doctor or something. Who I have here with me is Eli Kleinman. This guy is from Switzerland, and he's having paranormal experiences in his home. So I thought I'd let him come on here for a second, and we're going to talk to him and find out what's going on. So, Eli, how you doing?
I'm doing fine. Everything's good. Howdy, howdy. And how are you?
I'm alive here. So, tell me what's going on, man.
What's going on? Let's start from the beginning. I had some paranormal... coincidentally, I had some paranormal... how can I say it? Encounters. I had some paranormal encounters of some sort. Once I had this paranormal encounter of my shirt being tugged by an unknown entity whilst I was doing the usual fatherly stuff to my son, taking care of him on the bed and everything. So all in all, I just had got attacked by my shirt. I looked to my side, and nobody was sitting next to me, so that was kind of unusual for me. That was the closest I could get by having a spirit sit next to me and telling me that that spirit is present.
That sounds pretty spooky, man. Yeah. Have you had anything else like that happen?
Well, not as I can remember, but there were some other occurrences where I got some voices heard whilst I was in Austria, for example, in an old apartment. Nobody was living next to us, like was in next door, because it was like a family home. It's a holiday home, and in this holiday home nobody was next to us, and it was really quiet. And I also didn't see any car parked outside of the house.
Okay.
So I heard in the middle of the night some voices in the shower, and I immediately thought, could be that somebody's with us. But I checked and nobody was around us. So I heard distant faint voices in the shower, and that was also one of the spooky things that I also got into encounter with.
In the shower, huh? What about the other instance you told me about, a toy in a chair?
Whilst I was doing that fatherly stuff, as I also mentioned, there was also an occurrence where my son is sitting on that chair. He has a toy, which is a knot and is tied up around the chair. In the middle, between his legs, is a toy. It's attached to a string. And the toy was lying on the chair where he's sitting on, and somehow I heard from my room that the toy fell down. It got pushed down, and I heard the noise of the toy being pushed down. And as I know, my wife was in the kitchen and her sister were doing something completely different. Nobody was near the chair, so I don't know how it could occur.
I've had that sort of thing happen to me before, not with a toy, but yeah. Is there anything else that you might have a few seconds to tell us here before we go on?
Seconds? I would like to just input a fact that I am very sorry, but I have no evidence anymore, but I captured once on video on my cell phone a ghost orb whilst my wife was having her ritual day after, I think it was after or before Christmas, that I put my cell phone to record and to recharge at the same time during the night, and I captured a few white orbs moving around the candles and the pictures of the deceased family members, because we put pictures up and it was a special moment. And I saw and I heard once that the white orb not knocked down but it moved the candle light, and the candle started to dimmer a little bit whilst the orb passed by, and it also made a noise whilst it was going by a picture frame, but it didn't move anything. So I kept really quite a few orbs that night, but as I mentioned earlier, I apologize, but I don't have the evidence.
Well, that you don't need to apologize for that, man. So you think these orbs were your dead relatives, is what you're saying?
Well, yes, and also my wife's relatives as well. We also put pictures of her relatives as well. So I think from my side it's like three people, and from her side it's more like four or five-ish. I'm not sure exactly, but it was for sure more than my side.
Very interesting. All right.
Interesting indeed. Yeah, I must say I captured quite a lot. It was really, really interesting. But I'm planning to in the future to do that one more time, and maybe somehow to post it on the site so that people can see. And really, I would like to prove skeptics wrong.
Well, that would be cool. All right, Eli, we're out of time. And
sorry about that.
That's just fine. All right, and we're going to move on to the next topic here. Thanks for calling in. All right. Eli is in Switzerland. As I said before, it's like 4 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning or something right now. So that guy's in bed for no other reason than he can get up and take care of his baby, who I have with me now, and yes, this is live. We are live now. I have Carol Rock. I met Carol on Empire back in the day, and she's a witch. Carol is from New Jersey, but I met her in Colorado, and I met Rick at the very same time. Carol also has a pet grooming business, and we're going to talk to Carol about being a witch, about spirituality, and we're going to talk to Carol about a couple other things that might be a surprise to you guys. So anyway, Carol, welcome to the show, and how are you doing, sis?
I'm doing fine. How are you doing tonight?
Well, I'm here. You know, since we talked, I've been kind of like fighting off the... It's been really gloomy here, so I've been fighting that crap off again. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah. We've had snow here. It's cold. Colder than a witch's tit.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, snow here too. We had snow. It's supposed to be zero in the morning, and on my birthday, which is Saturday.
I know. Yeah, and you know what today is?
Today is a cold day.
No, today is Richard and my anniversary, 10 years. You and Kelly were at our hand fasting, which we did after we got married across into Michigan, because that's what we had to do for me to become legal here in Canada. I had to become his wife, the law.
Right.
So, 10 years. Can you believe it?
I forgot.
Wow.
10 years, man. What the? Oh, dude.
Yeah.
It's been that long. It has been
crazy. Crazy. Where's the time gone?
No doubt, you know.
And as you know, Richard and I are twin soul flames, and we can discuss that.
Yeah, why don't we do that right now? Explain to us what a twin soul flame is.
Exactly. We've heard of people saying, I've met my soulmate, and there's a lot of soulmates out there, but twin soul flames are where the essence of Rick and I split in half. So the soul actually split in half. We are twins. And we are twins in every sense of the meaning, as human twins. We speak the same thing at the same time. We have to occupy the same space at the same time. It can be very annoying.
Yeah, I was about to say that.
Yeah. And we chose this time, this meeting, when I actually met him face to face, was our time on this planet to be together. Doesn't happen too often. You won't see too many twin soul flames floating around there. But, that's what we are.
Well,
so it's been quite a journey so far.
You know, you used to talk to me about twin soul flames all the time, and we'd go round and round about that, but I'm starting to believe you for one reason. You would have killed it by now otherwise. I'm joking, Rick.
Well, you know, I knew of him when I was a child, and I had this feeling, I could never see his face, but I could feel his energy. And I would spend many times in bed as a child, sort of being frightened and needing calming down. And I would feel him next to me, and I just knew his energy. Could you hold 1 second?
Yes, I can hold 1 second.
Thanks. Rick?
Yeah, she's got to take care of her dog there. Yeah. But anyhow, she is an amazing lady, and we are going to get into several topics here, and hopefully it's very enjoyable for everybody out there. One of the funny things that's going on here with this weather is that it gets very cold, then it gets very warm, and it's like we got a half inch of snow, And then as soon as it stopped snowing, it melted away.
Okay, I'm back. Sorry. It was okay. An emergency.
That's fine. Not a problem.
Yes. When you got to go, you got to go.
Hey, you know, this is live radio and shit happens.
Yeah. I told him to be quiet, but he just had to go. So. Mm-hmm. And Rick was in the other room. He had his headphones on. He was working on piano, so he couldn't hear him.
Well,
so, sorry, guys.
Well, Max is one of these little bitty poodles. He's a poodle, right?
Yes, he is. He's a miniature poodle. One of our familiars.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so.
Yes.
When he's one of those stubborn animals that when he's got something to say, you're going to hear it, whether you want to or not.
I'm sure you heard.
Yeah. Right.
So. Anyway, we were talking about twin soul flames, Rick's energy and my energy. I always knew about him, but I also knew that I had another that I had to be with. Rick is my second husband, that I had to go through the beginning of my journey before I could hook up with Rick, so to speak. And some of my background is I am an adopted child. I was adopted at 6 months old.
Right, Carol, but hang on, let's back up a second.
Okay.
In your journey that you take in your life, there are things that you need to do. Or
correct.
You have to come back again and do it over again because you didn't get the experience and the lessons that you should have had the first time around in this incarnation. And so... that's what Carol was referring to.
Correct. And
so go ahead, there.
And this time around, I basically come back as a watcher and just trying out all the things that I have been in past life. In this life, it's very bizarre. You and I know we've been through the witchcraft thing, and witches were burned, and we weren't allowed to speak about ourselves.
And they were burned.
So this time around, I keep a low profile. I'm basically practice alone, and because all that is still in your cellular makeup, I don't care what anybody says, but that is in your cellular makeup, and you remember that it's a past life.
Yeah,
we can't get rid of it. Can't get past it.
Yeah, exactly. The witches were hung, they were smashed, they were drowned, along with innocent people.
Yes,
and. You know, they were burned overseas. They didn't do that so much here. I don't think they did that here. I think they just hung them here in this part
of
the
world. We weren't here necessarily then.
No. that comes up to my next question. What past lives do you remember?
Well, I know that I have Native background. I am very close to... wolf packs, so I have a great feeling of belonging to a pack, and there are others that I go in dreamscape with that I'm with. They're part of the pack. My ex was part of the pack. I have an affinity with water. I don't think that I lived on land. I think I lived in the oceans for a very long time.
By choice, correct?
By choice,
yeah.
Yes.
In other words, by choice is a lot of us feel and think that we choose what life we want to come back as, what we want to experience.
It all depends on what, not to interrupt you, but it all depends on the lessons that, what entails in the lesson that we've come here for.
Well, yeah, that's part of it too. Yeah. I agree with you.
Yeah.
We feel like... okay, I can get a better lesson for what I want to learn through this incarnation if I do this, and
correct.
If I'm born here, and on that side of the plane, it's not about monetary anything. It's all about life and experiencing life, because when you're on the other side, you know absolutely everything there is to know. When you come over here, you are cut off from source, so to speak. And you have to, you experience what it's like. It's like reading a book. When you read a book and you learn, you've got all that textbook book knowledge about how to, well, if you're in electronics, how to put together a ham radio. Well, then you go into your incarnation as a physical manifestation and you experience building that ham radio. If that makes a good analogy of what I'm trying to explain here.
Oh yeah, exactly. And every experience, every journey we've made, we accumulate all this information, and it's in our cell level, and we can tap into it, and we feel it. People have had deja vu. Oh, I've been here before. I've had money before, or I've died like this before. It's deja vu, and it's simply in our cellular level that we remember. We bring it back. We do. We tap into it.
Right. We tap into it and we learn from it. I have had experiences where I've been stuck in situations where I absolutely had no clue how to do something, but boom, there
exactly.
You go.
Yep.
You know,
exactly.
So I get myself out of a jam that way.
Or we get ourselves into a jam because we haven't figured out a past experience. We didn't figure it out, and this time we gotta get it right.
Right.
You've always been a traveler. You've always been a gypsy, Paul.
Always.
And you've lived out off the land for so many lives that you're so comfortable in that, you know.
Well, to me, monetary things don't really mean anything. It's the experience. It's
not this time. It doesn't. Exactly.
It's fun. It's fun to be that way. It's fun to... I don't stand in other people's shadows. I like to create my own.
Mm-hmm.
If that made any sense.
Yes, I like that.
Okay, and...
write it down, Rick says.
Yeah. I knew he was standing right there. So, anyhow. So, what is going on? I know you're not so... You're not the type of witch that sits there in front of your cauldron and... you know, stirs your cauldron and does these incantations and throws bat wings and so on and so forth in your cauldron and flies on a broom. You are the type of, as am I, you're more the type of person that, well,
they call
when
me
you
natural,
want it to happen.
Okay, I like going with natural.
Yeah,
I have to shine, but I have a natural witch.
When you want it, it happens.
It's there.
You manifest it for yourself.
Exactly.
When someone misbehaves, you trip them. I mean, Rick's going to hit me.
Don't be looking at me, buddy. I'm not the only one who can trip, okay?
Yeah, I realize that. She did that to me.
She can drop a house on anybody.
Yeah, she does. She can drop a house on. So explain.
We have to learn to control ourselves, our anger. We have to control our frustrations, but sometimes it's out of our hands, and there's something around me that always seems to handle things without me having to consciously do anything about it. It just happens, and I find out in the aftermath that this happened to this person or this situation, this is how it worked out, with me actually focusing on it. I don't have to focus on it, okay?
Right. It's... What I want everybody to do right now is I want everybody to take a piece of paper.
Yeah.
And I want you to draw a line on that piece of paper. Then I want you to draw like a quarter circle over top of that line. And on the bottom line, I want you to draw a stick figure. That stick figure is you. All right, the line on the top represents source. Source is neither good, bad, or indifferent. Now draw a line to that source. Then you become connected to that source. What way that you want to do that, you give yourself to your higher power. You give yourself to yourself. However, which way you do that, then you make that line up there that you just connected into, that source, you make it vibrate. And when you make that line vibrate, like, you know, taking your finger and hitting a rubber band, it's tight, that's when you can do something. That's when you make things happen for yourself and everything around you.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Does that make sense, sis?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Good analogy.
That's the best way that I can explain it to you. So, anyway, can you tell us how you would do that? Get yourself to be able to do that? Or how you personally make stuff happen? Or without giving away secrets?
Well, it comes naturally to me, Paul. As a child, I would spend a lot of time outside and watch the clouds. It was a game. And it would be a perfectly sunny day where there'd be clouds outside. And just for fun, I would bring this cloud a little closer to me, a little darker, a little closer, a little closer, and then make it rain. And my mother would say, call me Beulah the Witch, and tease me about it. That's another thing about, I don't even want to go into the child thing of how you treat children like us, but
right.
It kind of didn't care for it too much. But that was things I like to do for fun. I like to spend time with dogs or cats, whatever animals we had. I just like to spend time with them and just listen to them. It's not like they speak to you, they show you images in your head. That's why I'm a dog groomer, and I'm a vet tech too. So I see images. They just pass on images, places they've been, things they don't like, smells they don't like, smells they smell, things that they've eaten that you can taste in your mouth.
Right.
It's they send you images.
I always tell people I can speak baby or I can speak dog or what have you. And it, when you get close to animals, it's really easy to start to be able to pick up on what they're trying to tell you, even if it's just from watching their actions. Mm-hmm. Even because my one dog, Loki, the boy, he will actually try to speak. Sugar could speak before Sugar died, our other shepherd. But Loki will try to speak, and he will tell me just simple things. You know, I want to get out of, you know, being locked up in the kitchen, or I want to go out and mm-hmm. Do my business outside or whatever. But I don't even have to be looking at him. I could be engrossed in the TV watching The Walking Dead, for example, and he will just put something in my head, and I have to turn and look at him and say, what do you want? And the same thing goes when I was raising Willow. I could understand what Willow was telling me because of how you just explained it when she was 3 months old.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody else could understand her, but I could understand her, and I thought that was just freaking amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the reasons why we connect with animals is because they're not as complicated as humans. They don't have all that stuff. They're very unconditional. They're very trusting. And when they're angry for a reason. When they're happy for a reason. When they need something, they make it known to you very easily, very simply. They're not as complicated. They don't manipulate like a human being does.
Right.
There's no manipulation there at all.
So tell us about, since we're talking about dogs right now, we can go into the pet grooming thing, and then we can talk about how we're treated as kids when we're weird and not like everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
So you've been a dog groomer and a cat, not just a dog groomer, but
Texas. This is before Rick. I lived in Fort Worth, and I was hired by a veterinarian in Fort Worth, and she took me on first as a tech. She was very, it was before you had to go to school. This vet took people in, and she trained them herself the way she wants things done. She taught you how to draw blood. You could be in surgery with her. How to give some vaccinations, how to do x-rays and all that. And I worked for her like that for a while. And then she went into the grooming. She decided that was when the grooming was getting big, where the clinics were picking up groomers and they were making more money having groomers in there. So
right.
She took me in as a groomer.
Okay.
So I groomed for prior to that, I worked at a pet store, and I had I managed a pet store, and I had a bunch of girls I groomed. So I watched them, and I learned by watching. It's bizarre. It's something like I had done all my life.
Right.
Just picked it up. So.
So you went from there to Colorado.
Yeah, Fort Worth to Colorado. I had worked with this veterinarian. She got into working with stones and lights and sounds with the animals. So we got into the esoteric. That was my first taste of that, and realizing there were other people besides myself, the way I was.
Explain.
There were others out there.
Hold on, Carol. Explain what esoteric is.
We worked with sick animals. We would bring them in and play something kind of like Anya, but not Anya. We used lights that worked with their auras to help calm them and to bring their energy back up where we could, if they were being prepped for surgery, that sort of thing.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Dentists do that now, actually. I've been to a dentist that does that. They use the music and lights to calm you while they're working on you. So that's what we were doing with animals. But as I was living in Fort Worth, I was going through a phase of trying to decide where I fit in. And I went through books on cryon, went through books on how to this, how to that. I came across working with crystals. I collected a lot of crystals, tarot cards, dabbled in Reiki. Then I found something on automatic writing. And I picked that up, and I just went through that book like I devoured it. And over a weekend, and come that Monday, I picked up a pencil and paper and started the automatic writing, which came to me very easy. That's how I wrote my book, I Am the Path. That was automatically written. And from there, the automatic writing went into channeling, total channeling. The pencil got dropped, and they worked through me channeling verbally.
Right. So with your channeling, do you just take a digital recorder and set it in front of you and start doing it that way, or how do you do this?
No. If someone comes to me and they ask me something, sometimes it's not me anymore that's answering them. Their answer comes through Creator, and or someone that's already passed on the other side. The information just comes and just flows out of me.
Right.
I don't have to write it down. I don't record it. I just tell Rick, this is what I feel about somebody.
Right. I know. And so with your pets, you've got your business going. Is it going really good now up there in Canada with you?
Oh yeah. I'm very happy with it. Yeah, I don't worry about it. I don't worry about the animals coming in, the money coming in. It's one of those things that I'm just taking care of, you know.
Right.
I don't worry about it.
Okay, so let's jump back there to when I was a child.
Yeah.
I told this story before. You guys have seen The Wonder Years. The guy, the kid with the tape around his glasses, that was me.
Yeah.
You know, I was odd. I was weird. I would come up and I didn't understand what I was doing, but I would come up and give you a reading about something. That's what I was doing. And a lot of the times that would get me into a lot of trouble with the other kids because, you know, back then there wasn't any such... it wasn't treated the same
cool.
as it was
yeah.
now. You know, so, you know, if one kid beat the hell out of another kid, it was just one of those things that happened. And... so, but how difficult, explain to me the difficulties that you had while you were growing up.
Well, like I said, I was adopted at 6 months, and that connection with the parents, that cellular connection I know that you're supposed to have, that I have with other things, I didn't have it with them.
Right.
Not that I didn't love them, not that they didn't take care of me, but there was something missing there. And so I spent a lot of time trying to figure out my mother, what was going through her head, trying to figure out why she did the things that she did, thinking that she was protecting us, and my brother, who's also adopted. manipulation with my friends in school. I had gone to a girlfriend's house and her little dog bit me accidentally. I didn't find out until my senior year, because this girl was a good friend of mine and she no longer was a friend of mine. This was like in third grade. I didn't find out until my senior year when she came to me and she said, "I'm sorry, Carol, do you know what happened to us?" And I said, "No." And she said, "Well, your mother had my dog put down because the dog bit you."
Oh, wow.
So see, there was behind the scenes things that were happening to me that I was being kind of kept in the dark from, knowing it was there but not wanting to believe that it was really there, you know what I'm saying? Especially if it's a parent.
Not wanting to believe that the people you were supposed to trust were screwing you.
Exactly. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I went through the same thing.
You know, as a young kid, I loved kindergarten. I never liked kids picking on other kids. I liked everybody. I wanted everybody to be happy, and I didn't want anybody to be sad, you know? And as you get older, you find out stuff that life isn't so. You know? Right. It's just not the way it is. Kids can be very cruel. And if you're different, they're even cooler, right?
Right, right. Or, you know, with us, people will be nice to our face and they'll act like they're our friend, but they're scared to death of us and they really don't want anything to do with us.
Oh yeah. And when I used to be angry at my mom, I can remember walking down the sidewalk. Do you remember that saying, "Don't step on the cracks, break your mother's back"?
Right.
I used to step on every crack.
Me too.
Isn't that terrible?
Yeah. I could. It's sad. I hate my mother.
Well, so. I didn't hate her. I just was trying to understand her. She passed away this summer, and she was not a happy woman. She was not a happy lady, and it was all of her own doing. It's very sad to go through life like that, but I learned there was a lesson there for me to learn, not to go through life like that, and I did not bring up my three sons that way.
Right.
And my three sons are stable in knowing that their mother loves them. And that we're tight. You know, there's no manipulation there, ever.
Right. So. I have gone through, and Carol has actually helped me throughout the years. She has, you know, talked to me extensively on Yahoo about certain issue or whatever issues were going on, and you know, we've argued, of course, quite a bit. But one of those times, I was talking to Carol on Yahoo just before I went to work, and I was living in Sedona, and I was going to take my mountain bike and ride the 5 miles over through the mountains that I really wasn't in shape to do to go to my job. Carol was talking to me, and we were talking for, what, a good 2 hours? Or something like that.
Yeah, weren't you doing something with glass or windows or something at the time?
Yeah, I was. I had the glass repair business.
Yes.
And I was out there in the desert. The when they had sandstorms, it will literally tear your windshield or your house. These rich people would have windows that would be 15 feet high, an inch thick, and 4 feet wide. And instead of paying $1,800 for a new window when it got all scratched up, they would give me a call, and I would take the scratches out for a few hundred bucks. Yeah. And that's the business that I had. However, I went to my work, and lo and behold, I had me a heart attack. You know, and that was something that neither one of us seen.
No.
We didn't see that coming.
No.
I guess it's we don't see everything. And, you know, the lesson in that is that there are things that you have to experience that you cannot get out of. You can't get around some things. It doesn't matter what you do or how good you are or whatever you do.
No.
You got to get
and
through
if,
that.
And if I had seen it, would I have even told you? Probably not. I kind of made a deal with spirit. I really don't want to see my son's death. I don't want to see Rick's death. I don't want, there's certain things I do not want to see.
Right.
But you're right. If I had seen that, I don't know if I would have told you. Probably not. But if I had, it would have probably set you on a different course. And that's not good, because you're good exactly where you're supposed to be right now. I mean, you never would have come to Colorado with us. You never would have met Kelly.
Well, I don't know. In the frame of mind, I probably would have gone anyway, because I was in that one frame of mind that I've, you know, when I get depressed. So.
Yeah, but you had to experience that, okay? You had to experience that.
Okay, so are you?
You have to listen to your body, okay, Paul? And you weren't scanning yourself at the time. You weren't listening to the body.
Yeah, I wasn't listening to much anything.
Yeah.
So are you ready to take some questions?
Questions?
Yeah, from the.
Sure, I guess.
Well, if you want to. Get on Skype with us, then go to the main page of blackswampradio.net, scroll down, and there's a Skype link where you can Skype and be joined in with us, and you can ask Carol a question, ask me a question, or what have you. If not, that's fine too, but I thought that I would open the lines up for questions, since that's the thing to do these days.
Yeah.
And anyhow, I'm kind of at the end of what to talk about here. So,
What do you think? We were discussing a couple days ago this new energy that's coming through, where the old regime, the old energy is passing through.
Oh, yeah. Thanks. Okay. Thanks for bringing that up, because I forgot about that.
Let's discuss that.
Yeah, I forgot all about that. You know, sometimes my mind just, you know, goes. I can remember what happened 10 years ago, but I can't remember what happened 2 days ago.
Yeah.
And it's old age, I guess.
Unless you have someone coming on to talk.
No, I don't. We can talk the rest of the hour if we want to. If not, you know, I'll open up the lines and we can have open lines. But yeah, the new energies that are coming in, we are going into the age of Aquarius. That has started, but it takes a good 150 years to complete the cycle. Mm-hmm. So the old ways don't work anymore. The old ways of and they're starting to stop working, where you would take your herbs and you would do your blessings and try to do your magic that way and your manifestations and make something happen. That's on its way out. And anybody in spiritualism will tell you that's worth their weight in gold, will tell you that it's on its way out, and new energies are coming in. And one of the ways, the way I told you earlier, is one of the simplest ways to get started with that, and one of get to that point where you can even connect to source. That's why meditation is so important, because you calm yourself and you focus on one direction. And if you need to ask for help, your guides or your higher power or your higher self or whatever the way you want to put that will help you, and you will connect. And then after you're connected, you will be taught from your spiritual guides how to do things. So go ahead, Carol, and explain more of it, because I know I didn't cover it all.
Well, no, that's good. That's fine. You have to learn to be quiet and go within yourself. You have to be in a place where you can be alone and you have quietness and you can actually listen within. But the new energy that I'm talking about here, because you and Rick were talking the other night, and I went outside And I was just thinking, and I came back in and wrote down what this information I was getting, and it's like the new energy is emerging and taking place, replenishing forgotten things that worked in the past to keep our earth bodies intact, to revitalize Mother Earth. We lived in the fear tactics that we're living in, where the government has us under their thumb. We've been lied to by the politicians. We've been lied to by government. We've been lied to by parents. We've been lied to from the church. We've been lied to. It's time to take our stand and stand for ourselves. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We've been giving away our power. We got to take our power back.
Yeah, exactly. Period. We have to take our power back before we can do anything, before we can grow spiritually, or we're going to be stuck in the same place 100 years from now in our next lives.
Oh, as no, we we're are not right be now. Stuck because Mother Earth is replenishing herself. We'll be rolled over and removed. Period.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
I kind of agree with that. That kind of fits with some of the stuff that's supposed to be happening this year, like Yellowstone going poof and so on.
They've been talking about that for years. What are they saying now? I haven't read anything. What's going on there now?
Well, I will talk to you offline, or off the air about some of this, because there's some stuff that we have to talk about anyway. But 2036 is in May or something like that, is when Yellowstone goes poof. And then in October, there's another super volcano on the other side of the globe that's going to go poof. And that's not going to extinguish human life, but it will set it back 300 years.
Why the year 2036? What is the...
That's when I've been told it's going to happen. That's when I've seen, literally, that it's going to happen. I'm not the... There's other people that... there was that other time traveler guy. What the hell was his name?
Oh, yeah. I know who you're talking about.
Yeah,
Art
Teeter,
Bell, right?
Teeter said 2036. I don't know how he come up... That's another opinion and everything else. I'm not going to go there with it.
Yeah.
But... And I've been able to figure out a few things myself lately, as far as time travel is concerned.
Okay.
And but that coincides with what you just said. If the human species does not get their shit together very soon, Mother's done. She's had it. She's tired of being destroyed. She's tired of being polluted and made sick. And it's time for things to start new.
Yeah.
So, anyhow.
It's not a doomsday thing that I'm trying to make everybody feel, but it's just the fact that the old energy no longer works. We're seeing it time and time again.
Right.
So.
The old energy, compare it to a computer. If you tried to use an old 486 with DOS and get on the internet and do anything at all, you know, something might try to come up, but it's not going to work. It's going to crash on you. And that's why you have to learn the new ways of doing it. It's like the old ways of putting electronic devices together. In a new way.
When we were on Empire, there were so many people that, because I worked with a lot of people, as you know, on Empire. I did readings and guidance. There was a lot of sleepers.
Yeah,
I don't see that so much anymore. They're either awakening or they're coming in fully awake.
Or they're just hiding with their head in the sand like they always have.
Yeah, that's that too. But the children I'm impressed with. The children are what we're going to leave them with. the crystal children now, they have so much crap that's being left in their hands to deal with, to work with. We're not leaving them much, but they're strong enough to turn things right again.
They're strong enough to be able to stand up and say we've had enough and actually do something about it.
Right.
Where in this day and age, people are like, I don't want to stand up and do anything because they're just going to walk over me anyway.
Well, that's because that's the old energy, and that's the way it's always been.
Yeah, and very
that's
shortly.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Very shortly, that's not going to happen anymore.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. I have the characters in my novel that that they got into a situation in my novel where they were surrounded by gangsters, and they didn't kill them at first.
Mm-hmm.
What they did is that when the guns were drawn, they used their minds. They made the metal of the gun so hot that they had to drop the gun, and the metal would fuse so that the guns were inoperable. And that part is what's going to become the normal with the children today. It's not a superpower, it's thought. Everything that comes out of this world in the first place comes from the dream time.
Yep.
Dreamscape. This all comes out of dreamscape. This is the physical manifestation of dreamscape. Carol mentioned earlier about doing things in dreamscape. Well, dreamscape is lucid dreaming. Lucid dreaming is the same, very same thing. It's just two different words to describe the same thing. Lucid dreaming or dreamscape, whatever you want to call it, that's more true than what's sitting in front of you right now. Because, and the crystal children understand this, and the crystal children can make the things happen because they know and they are allowed to remember that, oh, where is it that I want to go with this here? They're allowed to remember that this is a dream and that you can do whatever the hell you want to. You still have to learn your lessons for the reasons that you came here, but you can do whatever you want to as long as you're not breaking the one law of the universe, which is free will.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
Right.
Right. Okay. And that's what has been taken away from us with the old with free will.
Yeah,
giving our power away. Yeah.
Yeah. We give our power away because we're told to. We're told that we are worthless and we are not equal to the source that we are created from. And when if you look in physics will tell you that we have to be just as equal as any part of the other parts of the universe, or we cannot exist. If that makes sense.
Yeah. And how much ego is it that we carry that we think that we're the only ones living, the planet Earth is it? You know? Cracks me up. when we're on the other side, we can go anywhere and get our lessons any place we want. When you're dying in bed and you leave your body and you're just roaming around the hospital, you don't have to stay in the hospital. You don't even have to stay on Earth. You could go anywhere you wanted to before you moved on. You know?
Yeah, I agree. And a lot of the times you see examples how that happened, or you hear examples of at the moment of death, the child will come into the parent's room and say, I just saw Grandma.
Mm-hmm.
And the parents will go, what the hell are you talking about? She's in the hospital. And they'll blow the kid off. And it's like, that's the most harmful thing you could ever do.
Yeah. Out of the mouths of babes.
Exactly. So anyhow, people, open lines here. Or you can ask Carol a question. You can ask me a question. But come on and give me open lines.
And we've got Rick here, too.
Yeah, and Rick Rock is here, too. He's sitting right next to Carol. Yeah. You remember Rick from, was it last week? Week before? Or last week. Oh, here we go. We've got Sir Bear calling. Come on.
I know nothing about it. Rick is in here more than
I am.
Are
you there, Bear?
He's trying to, somebody wants to talk to us. Okay, I see Sir Bear.
Yeah, I'm trying to get him on here.
Hello.
Do I have to accept him or just you?
Hey, okay. Bear. Bear, could you kill your video, please? And
I can kill my video.
Thank you. Yeah, I got so much resources going on this here thing. So anyhow, do you got a question for Carol, or do you got something else you want to talk about?
Oh, I just wanted to say hi to everybody and ask Rick if he's ever in this part of the neighborhood, if he could slip me a couple tickets to his concert.
Absolutely. Where are you from?
I'm in the San Francisco Bay Area.
San Francisco. You know, it's
California.
Funny. Our guitar player just was there in that area. It's pretty profound. And he's got some connections with an agency and another guy that, and we might be doing something around that area, maybe as early as the fall. But yeah, keep in touch on Facebook or so. I can look under Simply Queen on Facebook and
I don't do Facebook at all. So
okay, I'm email. You can get our email, Paul, and just go through email. I can send you some things, but nothing scheduled yet. But we're waiting for some stuff.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I know Paul real well. In fact, I give him a bad time. I'm his biggest pain in the bottom there is.
Good. He needs a shake it sometime.
Yeah. Bear's a good guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What? Okay.
So, anyhow.
Anything else?
Yeah, go ahead. Is there anything else? Does anybody else want to call in here?
You guys see anything coming up in the near future as far as positive or negative? Or
the energy?
Right. Are you speaking about the energy we're talking about? We're in an influx now. You can see what's going on with our candidates in the United States. I'm an American. I'm living in Canada, but I'm watching what's going on over there with Donald Trump.
Did you hear about what went on here?
Where is here, hon? Where are you at?
Santa Clara, Levi Stadium.
No, what happened there?
Oh, our mayor, the day after the Super Bowl, got entangled in a bunch of conspiracy stuff and just got up and quit and resigned 2 years, in the middle of her term.
Yeah. That's all what we're talking about, what's going on now. It's just not working anymore. They're getting caught. The old ways do not work anymore, period.
They're either fed up with what's happened or
the people are getting people are fed up. The people are fed up. I'm surprised the United States haven't gone under civil arrest already, Paul. Truly, I am.
They had
the Amaro. They were going to go with the Amaro. That was already printed, okay?
Yeah.
Already printed. Never even came out. What happened over in Europe?
They want to go digital.
It went down, didn't it? That money system they changed.
Yeah, they want to go digital now. They want to make it with the Bitcoin. They want to use the Bitcoin. And the Bitcoin is going to be the new electronic currency where you have to be in the system all the way to have any money and finances whatsoever. You're not going to be able to live off the grid at all because you're not going to be able to just work.
It's the mark of the beast is what we're talking about.
Yeah, basically, the Bitcoin could be set as the mark of the beast. It's not going to be the chip in your wallet or the chip that they are talking about putting in your head or something like that. It's going to be the Bitcoin will be the mark of the beast because you have to have it. Everybody has to have money or they starve and they can't pay their rent and they can't pay for their utilities. So.
Right.
But the energy, I think, what is really going on is because of, not saying just Facebook, but the whole social thing is exposing everything from the healthcare to you know, policing. I mean, police are getting caught beating up people. You know, there's good and bad cops, there's good and bad everything, you know. The movies are dictating some things that are going on. And the whole world can make something go viral and stop something good or bad within hours.
Well, the whole thing, it looks great on the surface, but people still don't care. They don't believe. For one, I don't believe hardly anything I see on Facebook. And then two, when I do see a story, it's like, well, all right, that's what they wanted us to see. They want to give us. They want to give us. Well, Carol,
people are not taking that as word anymore. Now they're going on the internet and they're looking and searching for themselves. Like this gentleman said, did you hear what happened in my home? Well, I can very easily go and Google and see where he's talking about. Is that true or not? I could find that out within minutes, right?
Well, yeah.
I don't have to take Facebook's word for it.
But when the older people, the people my age, your age, a lot of people look at it as, well, the cops wouldn't have had anything to do with them if they weren't in the wrong in the first place.
That's, well, those are the ones that are going to wake up in the morning with everything gone.
Yeah.
Sorry. Yeah.
They are
going
to wake up.
I see the rotten underbelly of what's going on around here real good.
Explain, Bear.
Oh, the corruption, the forced shots on kids, you know, and they're trying to force that on the seniors as well. Just the whole police, you know, labeling system that they have here now, everything.
Well,
it's just rotten. It's, you know, to control.
Well, the way I look at it, when cops can, there was an incident in Cleveland, I think people know who I'm, or what incident I'm referring to, where there was a couple, a black couple, that got stopped, and cops, one of the cops jumped on up on top of the hood, and the other cops, and they had no weapon. And they fired like 150 damn bullets into the car and killed them. And they all still have their jobs. You know, and it's, people see that. And so they don't even think for a second that there's a way out. They think,
well, there's been riots. Detroit had some riots. Where was that other place? Was it Missouri? The riots,
yeah, but that didn't really accomplish anything because the media went right behind them and said what people believed because the media is who said it, and also the riots that were caused where you're talking about, most of those people didn't even live there that came in and started the riots. They went in there purposely to burn stuff and destroy.
Thing in Burns, Oregon is getting nasty.
In Burns, Oregon. Oh, yeah, with the ranchers?
The ranchers.
Yeah. The FBI is surrounding them. They're going in.
Well, you know, for people that don't know about the Oregon deal and how it started, basically it was wrong because the people that were sent to jail in the first place for burning... burning brush. They went to jail. They did their time. They got out of jail, and a judge said, you didn't spend enough time in jail.
A federal judge.
You didn't spend enough time in jail. I don't like that you only got this amount of time. You have to go back to jail. That was totally wrong, totally illegal, totally off the wall. That's what started the whole thing. The media is not going to tell you that because it's not in their favor. You know, so the people that were there protesting had a legit reason to be there, but everybody else in the country who just watches the news and doesn't do the research because they have too much of whatever else is going on in their life don't get anything, and they don't know what really happened.
Well, the whole reason for this was it not the ranchers' property, which the government wanted to take over? Am I correct? And that's what started this whole thing?
From what I understand, it was the stuff that was burnt was on federal land.
But it was endangering the homes.
It was endangering the other people's property. It was going to cause a wildfire, and cause a whole lot of mess. So they did what they did, and I think something about they wanted to take their land at the same time that they arrested them or something. I think that had something to do with it too. But see, I'm not even clear on everything. So. But back to my point of, it's real difficult to wake people up when they live in so much fear, and that's exactly what the government wants them to be, is in fear. They want them to stay in fear because then they can do whatever they want to. Or the people don't have a clue. They play with their cell phones and they play with the internet and the video games, and they don't pay attention to anything but what immediately goes on in their life. I mean, they sit at the, I'm talking about the type of people that will, their family will sit at the dinner table, but every single one of the people at the house will be texting each other instead of talking to each other. You know, and that's crap. And people need to wake up and grow up, and that's why I think cell phones are evil. That's why I don't have a cell phone that
me either.
Get on the internet with and things like that. I limit my time on the internet, and I remember Carol and Rick remember a time when I used to live on a damn thing. So
we all did.
You know, it's getting back to some of this energy that's going on. People either. Three types of people: either people that are just totally in the dark and don't want to hear, or they're blind, they're just sheep, you know, cattle type thing, and forget it. They don't want to hear it. If it's right in front of their face, they don't want to hear it. Then there's the people who are freaking out about everything, you know, and tell everybody, and it's part of their nature of being stressed out, and that they live in that stress of worrying about everything that's going on, what we're going to do. Then there's people who, like actually yourself, Paul, who picks up on everything, but doesn't let it bother you. But it's like a need to know information. You know the information, but you're not going to freak out about it and change your life about it. But you're aware of it, okay? And you take whatever you want out of it. So that's three type of people that's living right now in this change of energy. That's what I think.
Or you get the kind of people like me that speak out and get themselves in trouble.
Yeah, well, that's the whole thing, because you're fed up.
Yep.
What if someone just quoted something and it was almost exactly what you just said there? You piss off somebody who's truthful or knows the truth long enough, and they'll just start, you know, they'll either rebel or just ignore you.
Well, I rebelled and got myself in some trouble.
Well, but that was your truth. That's what, you know, you're fed up with, you know?
Yep. So,
well, he didn't just rebel and get himself in trouble. He tried to help everybody out and got himself in trouble too. You know, he tried to help to bring in the new way of the way things are going, should be. And he ended up having to pay for it for the rest of his life. So.
I basically told HLS where to stick it. And they didn't take it so well, the repercussions.
Right. So.
Things are happening faster than ever. I mean, this, you know, like we talked about last week, you know, it's like a woman has labor pains, you know, faster and faster and faster. And that's what's going on with everything. I mean, the next couple of years is that it's crazy. What's happened in the last year is crazy.
Well, even in Santa Cruz, they're getting fed up and there's demonstrations going on. So it's not just local, you know, to where I live. It's pretty much statewide here.
Yeah, but the people that, like, for example, people like my mother, if it's not on the news, it never happened.
Yeah.
And so that's how they get around it. That's how they just blow life off and they live in their own little world. If it's not on the nightly news, the world news, it didn't happen. And we all know that there's maybe 2% of everything that happens every day that ever makes it to the world news. And there's a fraction of that that's not been twisted to someone's benefit that is broadcasted over the news.
So it's up to you if you want to take it into your life or not. That's, if you want it a part of your life, good or bad or whatever, you take. There's markers every single day. There's little signs that either people are awake and see the signs that happen in their life, or they're sleepers. So there's more sleepers than people awake.
But when the change gets here, finally starts to get here to the point where it's actually starting to affect things physically, people are going to go, oh, and they're going to start crying and wonder what's going on.
What's happening, the internet, I mean, the whole internet system and electronics, this last a month or two has been, I thought it was just me, but so many people, electronics are unstable right now. It's starting to happen everywhere.
I see it too. Right in the middle of something, the audio will kick out or the video will kick out. It's just like, hello, Google Barge out in the bay, right?
I play that more on the paranoid end. I think that they have a large enough people monitoring that they decide when they want to, like, mess with somebody's connection and in audio and all that kind of happy stuff. It's like I attribute some of the ghost activity to what went on with my cable connection and my cable modem, but at the same time, Time Warner knew, because I told them one of the reasons that I wanted to have as high of a connection as I did is for this radio show. And the first couple of times that I had problems with the internet, in fact, there was one show I couldn't even do because we didn't have any internet, is I think that they were trying to sabotage me purposely.
Oh my God, when you're on the internet, like when we're looking at cars or something, you get all these advertisements in your mailbox on cars. And it goes like, how did they know that I was looking at cars?
Because they're looking at you.
They're watching everything you do on here. Yep. Right?
Yeah, I know. Like,
didn't you say you were looking at cars and you said, look, I've got all these advertisements for cars, or if we're going on a trip or something.
Yeah.
All these resorts.
Yeah, it's like they know where you've been. They know exactly where you've been. That's why every single day, so what I've been doing is wiping out my history of wherever I've been, so that they can't get to it when you go anywhere online. It's pretty wild.
Yeah, we've got a guy, he took off for the last week. We haven't seen him around because he's a Vietnam vet. And he's really paranoid. He's got the software or the browser or whatever that changes the IP address constantly. And we're always razzing him about how paranoid he is. And he's always complaining he can't hear the show or something, or he can't do something because he can't accept the Java applet or whatever the case is. And I tell him, I said, well, you know, that's on you. You got, you know, don't be so paranoid, get over it and all this kind of neat stuff. But, you know, actually he's kind of dead on for the way that he's acting. It's not as paranoid anymore as you might think. Where 30 years ago, this could have got us locked up in a loony bin.
Yeah.
You know, for thinking like this, for talking like this.
I know who you're referring to.
Oh, yeah. I'm talking about Bean.
Yeah.
Hey, you know what happened with us tonight? This happens quite a bit, but this was really wild. I'm going to the fridge to look to see what we're going to eat for supper. So, and we got this little TV on in the living room, dining room here between the rooms. And I don't know, there's just a TV on, whatever. Carol's sitting up here near the computer. So I go into the kitchen and open up the fridge, and I say, "Hey, what's for dinner?
What do you want to make for dinner?"
What do you want to make for dinner?
Yeah.
And what did you say?
I said, "I don't know what I want." And
I don't know what. As soon as she said, "I don't know what I want," on TV there was a commercial or whatever it was.
"What do you want for dinner?"
The exact line that I just said within seconds after I said it. And she said something right between, like, split second. And the TV.
We just laughed.
And we just stopped and we went, another marker where we're at. Is it?
We call that snap in the room.
Yeah.
Is that freaky? I mean, it used to be like, you know, I'm driving down the. And I'll say, we'll be talking, we'll say like a word or something, and the radio will say, repeat, within seconds later, not before, seconds later, exact, like in something that is a word or a phrase that is bizarre, not really like something common, like, oh, look at, you know, something like that. But that was wild today. That was a freaky thing. But it was a full phrase, exact word for word, you know? And I don't know if that happens with other people, but you've got to realize what that is. So is that, are you perfectly where you're supposed to be in life? Or is that a message telling you something? That's what the key is. So what is it?
I think it's kind of like deja vu almost sometimes.
It's backwards deja vu.
No, it's not deja vu.
It's precognition.
Yeah,
that's more of what it is. It's precognitive.
I hope you guys didn't have Taco Bell. If you did, Frog, send them a picture of the Taco Bell cat.
No.
No, we didn't.
No. But I do want to ask Knight, you remember that picture that I put in the chat room last night with Norman Reedus and
the
zombie?
Zombie one?
And, yeah. Knight, what did you think about that in Skype? Did you see that?
Yeah, you know, I saw
that had me rolling on the floor laughing.
I was cracking up too.
You know that lady that you had on before us on The Walking Dead?
Yeah.
You know, they have such a huge audience. Do you realize what that is all about, Paul?
Yeah, it's trying to wake people up to the fact that things are going to change. It's not going to be zombies.
No, it's not that. It's our human nature. We have dreams like that. It's that fight or flight thing, and that is something we always have ingrained in us. Think about it. The zombies are coming. They're moving from one place to another to get away from the zombies, looking for a place that's safe to hide, place to eat. Do you know what I'm saying? That fight and flight thing.
Right, right.
That's why everybody is so pulled into that.
And it doesn't matter where you're at or what the situation is, the human species is violent. Always will be.
Well, you know the easiest way to take down a zombie, don't you?
Off with
his baseball bat to the kneecaps. They can't walk. They can't, you know, they don't have legs underneath them, right?
Yeah, they just drag themselves on the ground.
Yeah, they drag themselves on the ground. If it's in a script, they're going to bite you anyway, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
That's the key. The zombies, you know, I was going to go into a whole thing about how zombies were, they're just not possible. There's no way that a zombie could exist, period. It just can't happen. But I didn't. I just went in and ran a bit with Sylvia on it, Tanya,
like everybody's running around with the Zika virus.
But that's not.
No.
But that's
I wouldn't
not the
say
point.
Zombies
that's
don't.
Not the point. But Carol hit it pretty on the head there. You know, the zombie on the head. No. It's fight or flight. It's that the excitement of not the excitement, but the
adrenaline kick.
The nightmare of never being like safe, and, you know, always trying to escape from what's going on. And just when you think that you're okay, you're not okay. And it's got nothing to do, I think, with zombies. It's just a tool to get, you know, or whatever, to that nonstop of you're never going to kill them all and all that stuff. You're never, and it's like a nightmare. It is like a living
that
nightmare
that you can't get out of. Yeah.
You know?
Right.
Remember, they started with the Night of the Living Dead, and they started with what was the first zombie movie there? Well, pretty
cool. Dawn of the Dead, yeah. Night of the Living
Dawn
Dead.
Dawn of the Dead. No. That, I mean, that movie freaked me out when I was young.
Zombie movies have been out for ages with the witch doctors, and there are such things as zombies, my dear little brother.
Well, I realize that, Carol, but it's doctors, not. I'm talking about the zombies on The Walking Dead. The zombies on The Walking
Dead
are, you know, the TV zombies. That's not going to happen. The other zombies, that's another hour that we could explain how we can actually make other zombies and create them. But, you know.
Well, you can.
We got zombies running around here now. We talk about.
You can make a metaphor of.
Tell me about it. Look where I live.
Metaphor of a virus, you know. The
cancer patients, they're walking dead.
Yeah.
They're going through the chemo and radiation, they're walking dead.
Yeah. Yep, they are.
These viruses, we're walking dead. You know, it's actually real. And at any time with this mosquito virus or a bird virus can wipe out many, many people. And they're practicing on us. It's got to be. Or they're playing games with us.
Well, I firmly believe that the Zika virus is the latest thing in trying to thin out the population. Just watch what happens by summertime. They genetically modified mosquitoes, and then they came on the TV and said they only modified the male mosquitoes to try to kill off the mosquitoes with the Zika virus.
Yeah,
but what they actually did is they...
You know who's behind it, eh?
Who's behind it? Well, it's a way to make money with a vaccine.
Company. It's a company.
It's Bill Gates.
It's all about making the vaccine and making more money with the vaccine.
Bill Gates' his biggest priority right now is
No.
He's invested all of his time and money, and not all of his money, but he owns viruses. Vaccinations.
That's what it's about. That's what I just said. It's all about the vaccination and the money behind the vaccination. Only with the Zika virus, the way it's going to mutate, I think. And I do believe it's going to mutate, and it's going to cause a lot more problems than they can handle, because this virus is causing people issues where they cannot function, they cannot control their limbs. It's affecting the unborn children. You can get it as a sexually transmitted thing. It's out of control already, and they started this.
Rock, look out when it starts affecting your body or your bodily functions.
Wait a minute. Back up. What did we hear on the program?
It was the vaccination for the Brazilian women, actually, to keep them. It was a form of birth control. That's what he was testing.
But you know what? There's only.
This was the side effect.
They lied. There's only 250 cases.
There's not that many.
The lady was on the other night. Okay, coast to coast.
Okay.
She got the facts completely. They said there was 1,000. Well, there's only 250, 260 cases in South America. Okay? That's it. Do you know how many cases there are of this in the United States have been in the last year? Are you ready for this?
In the last few weeks.
No, last year in the United States of this virus in the United States, 25,000.
Yep.
But they're blaming the 250 that are only in Brazil, blowing it up. But actually, it's in the States, 25,000 already in the States.
That's okay? More than I was aware of.
But they hit it, yeah.
Yeah.
She was on. She explained it all. She's got all the facts. This is not something she made up. How's that?
Sounds like West Nile is a baby compared to this one.
Yeah, well, I don't listen to Coast to Coast. You know that.
Be.
I don't. Coast to Coast.
On one end, they're blowing it up. The other end, it's already... In the States, not 10 times, 100 times more than it is in South America already. It has been for last year. And there's how many people have died? Not many. I mean, she said more people have died of, you know, all everything, other type of causes than this, but they're blowing this up because vaccination, another cause to have everyone have vaccination, which is billions of dollars. Bill Gates.
There goes Big Pharma.
Yep.
Yeah.
Money for vaccinations again.
Hey, guess what? I wish he was here. This would have been an exciting night. We had, not last night, the night before, we stayed at our house here. A friend of a friend, and I welcomed him here to stay overnight. He's from London, Ontario. I'll just give his first name, Jamie. He was here for the night. We talked till wee hours in the morning, and then woke up early and started talking again. He worked for one of the biggest pharmaceutical companies, and for 25 years, he was basically a salesman for doctors. Okay.
Okay.
Until he got totally fed up, he had to leave it. He was getting sick over it, and he found the truth about a lot of stuff and pills he was pushing, and he did more and more and more research, and now he's on the other side, you know, promoting natural stuff and natural things and other options for people. But he has more stats in your head, but he was on the other side, and you wouldn't believe the trouble that he had going through the transition and stuff.
Wealth of information.
I believe it.
Well, I can believe it because
so there's proof. It's not someone that's a hearsay or some article. Okay, he lived it for 25 years.
I can believe how hard it is. You believe in one thing, and then you find out it was a lie, and you have to learn how
Lipitor
to live another way.
They make the most money. Lipitor is another thing, but there's so many other drugs out there that he said they're out there. All they want people to do is not cure the symptom. They, especially the diabetics, they don't want the diabetics to be cured of the diabetic. They just want to treat the symptom so that they can be comfortable, live comfortably, sort of, but the drug ends up backfiring everywhere else. And they want everyone on a lifetime drugs. That's what they're doing.
Yeah, because it's more
money. But it's your drug for lifetime.
It's more money that way. It's more, same thing goes with cancer and several other conditions.
It's not fixing anything, just masking everything.
Well, you know, it's like, they told me what? They told me I had like a year to live, and it's like I don't have anything to do with doctors. I don't go see the doctor, and I've been here. That was 2001 when I had that heart attack.
That's right.
You know?
Yeah.
Now, I think that if I had played into the little game, I'd already be dead.
For sure.
Ever see
they get you in the system because you have no medical insurance, man, you would have been last one seen of me.
Yeah.
You ever see The Sixth Sense, Paul?
Yeah.
You died in 2001. You're dreaming all this.
You know what, Rick? You're closer to the truth than you know. You know that? You are so close to the truth.
Listen to the Bowie song "We Are the Dead." It was freaking.
It wasn't in 2001 when I died, Rick. It was in 1986.
Okay.
And I'm still dreaming.
That's good. Good. What a trip, eh?
Well, Frog can tell you what I've been through. I was not supposed to ever, you know, make it.
No.
But he can tell you that off the air.
Yeah, yeah. Well, Rick, I think, Rick is familiar with your story. Not from me, but he's familiar with your story, Bear. I'll talk to Rick off air. And, anyhow, it is that time of the night. The show is done.
It's the witching hour. Come on.
It's the witching hour. The show is done.
Just getting going.
We are out of time. Thank you so much, Carol, for being here. Thanks for Rick being
here.
You're
welcome.
Thanks
for
Bear coming on.
Thank you guys for coming on.
Say good night there, people.
Good night, everyone, all 25 time zones.
We're going to have to do some experiments soon enough, okay?
Okay, so good night.
Good night, Paul. It was fun.
All right.